When I was small, this was the highest place in the world, and the biggest dare was to walk along this parapet. A man called Liam Nolan became a local legend when he walked along it on his hands. He won 15 bob in a bet, and it was probably the dearest 15 bob he ever made.
But such deeds of derring do attached themselves to the railway. It was something heroic, epic, which ran through our little mountainy kingdom. We slid down the embankments, we had hideouts under the bridges, we had halfpennies flattened into pennies by passing trains. As our mothers knew only too well, adventure was what happened down the railway. When it closed in 1963, we knew we wouldn't really miss the trains because, to be honest, there weren't all that many trains anyway. But it was when they started to take away the sleepers and the lines that we knew our playground would disappear. We were sad, but we weren't surprised. In reality, the most surprising thing about this lovely little railway line was the fact that it ever got built in the first place. Begun in 1855 and roughly tracking the River Barrow, it ran from Bagenalstown to my hometown of Burras, out along the foothills of Mount Leinster to Glynn, where it left County Carlow for County Wexford, running through Ballywilliam and Palace East and then west to New Ross. Now, straight away, you can see the problems. First, it was ruinously expensive to build across such mountainy terrain. Secondly, the countryside had more sheep than potential passengers. Thirdly, there are two rival lines running down either side, one through Wicklow to Wexford and Enniscorthy, the other through Kilkenny to Waterford. Fourthly, the Barrow and the Grand Canal already provided the competition of a long-established freight route. So this railway didn't make a lot of sense, except perhaps to one man. Well, railways always attract the brave and the adventurous, and this man, Arthur McMurrough Kavanagh, was all of those things. A descendant of the Kings of Leinster, he was heir to the great Kavanagh estates in South Carlow and Wexford. His home, still the home of his heirs today, is Burras House, the family seat of the McMurrough Kavanaghs. Among his ancestors were Dermot McMurrough, known to every schoolchild as the man who betrayed Ireland to the Normans, but also the great warrior king Art McMurrough Kavanagh, who successfully harried the invading armies of Richard II. This then was the notoriously inaccessible Kavanagh country, which had defeated generation after generation of attackers. Now the Kavanagh himself, Arthur, was going to tame it with a railway.
He very much wanted to be a progressive landlord, and he felt that the place needed to be revived. And I think very much at the time when there was railway fever, there was a tremendous idea of expansionism, and the idea of bringing the railway here, I think, represented something to him which really appealed to that age group. You know, he was very young. And I think he really wanted to do it because his commitment to the idea was enormous.
And everybody believed, didn't they, that railways were magic, that somehow, even without looking at the economics of it, they believed railways would bring prosperity.
I don't think they actually thought out how, but that it was a good idea. I don't know how they imagined it could ever pay for itself. Yeah. But it still seemed a huge dream and a huge ambition.
These were the years after the famine. Things were fairly tough. The notion of some big works like railways, like the building of the enormous viaduct in Burras, which would have given work to people, Arthur would probably have been very much in favour of that.
Yes, and I think the railway very much fitted into that ethos that you really needed to employ a lot of people, doing something which was seen as progressive and had a reason in itself rather than something just to give employment.
Like many of the great old Irish families who survived English rule, the Kavanaghs were now part of the Anglo-Irish ascendancy. But they were still the focus of local legend. It was said that because of Dermot's Norman treachery, they would be cursed, a curse completed by the birth of a crippled heir. Others said the curse was brought on by Arthur's mother, the determinedly Protestant Lady Harriet de Puer Trench, who had broken the arms and legs off a Catholic maidservant's statue of the Christ child. Whatever the truth, Arthur McMurrough, the champion of the railway, was indeed born without arms or legs. The tragic deaths of his two older brothers made him the heir. The prophecy of the crippled Kavanagh, claimed the local Greyheads, had indeed come true.
Every event like that has a prophecy to relate to it. I think it is more likely that his mother was on a herbal remedy at the time that she was carrying it. And I think, and it's probable, that it was some sort of early thalidomide or similar. And his mother's famous remark was, "Thank God he was born to me, no one else." Meant by that, I think that she knew that she would be able to look after him and probably had the money and the wherewithal to be able to do so.
And what did they eventually achieve with him in terms of what he was able to do?
From an early age, they realized that riding was going to be the way where he would feel more equal to everyone else. And, you know, that obviously was a huge attraction to him.
Of course, because on a horse, you're as tall as anybody else.
And you're mobile.
But without legs, how did he ride?
He was strapped into a special saddle, which he had made, which is a fairly frightening thought anyway, to be strapped onto a horse. Yeah. But I think the sheer joy of riding, the sheer joy of freedom that it brought, meant everything to him. So he travelled virtually everywhere by horse. I mean, and he had some horrible incidents. I mean, he was incarcerated in one of his travels in the village square and pelted with rotten eggs. And, I think because he was such a curiosity. Yeah. But on the other hand, this in a way saved his life, because afterwards on his travels he had to work on the Khyber Pass as a dispatch rider, where life expectancy was very short, but the pay was very good. And he was never harmed. And they still remember him, the legend of him, out there, because he must have been a fairly frightening sight. But no one ever touched him.
Also on that journey, he got left behind, didn't he, by his companions in Prussia, because he fell ill. And he ended up in a very, very comfortable place.
That's right. His sickness required the best possible attention, which meant being looked after in the harem. So he had a very happy 3 months there.
Yeah, I mean, there are descriptions of his being passed from lap to lap.
That's right, in
the harem.
Yes. It's reputed that the kind host is said that his education was nearly complete when he came to him, and now was complete.
Arthur makes no reference to his disability in his diaries, written with his pen held between his teeth. Here instead, we read of his achievements, his life as an MP, the opening of his local railway, which he saved twice from bankruptcy, until he admitted to the House of Commons that it had all been too expensive an adventure for a private investor.
In 1874, he finally realised that railways were no place for private individuals and private companies, and that it had to be funded by the government and taken over.
He also managed to put it into the safe hands of the two biggest railway companies in the 1870s.
Yes, I mean, I think he was very careful and very sure that it was going to have a future.
Yeah.
And he was successful in that. It was into the 60s before it finally did close.
The state took it over, and the state closed it down. By 1940, it had no passenger service except for excursion trains to the big hurling and football matches in Dublin and to Our Lady's Shrine in Knock. But it still provided a major service to farmers in winter, bringing the sugar beet to Carlo Sugar Factory. That too came to an end in 1963. In some ways, for the last halt keeper, Mrs. Eileen Lawler, and her husband, John, life since then has stood still.
Well, Mrs. Lawler, it's 33 years later, and you're still here.
Yeah.
And all the buildings are still here.
Yeah.
Tell me, do you remember the day they came to close the station down, take everything away?
In March 1963.
Yeah.
And they took away all the stuff, you know, such as lamp, all the paraphernalia from the station.
Are you sorry?
Yeah, I was. I missed it.
Did you?
Yes, I did.
Been there all your life?
Yes.
Yeah. There were days, I mean, the railway really only ran regularly for the beet campaign.
Beet campaign and excursions to Knock. And
was there great excitement on those days?
Pretty, oh, yes.
Was there?
Yeah.
And did people and come out to
often
see?
Often when the train at night time come back, I used to have to light this tilly lamp and I used to be afraid of my life. Does it blow up or anything, you know?
Yes.
I used to be real nervous of it.
That they might blow up.
Yeah.
Well, John, you remember the days when the whole town would turn out sometimes to see the excursion train head off to Knock, don't you?
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
And then there were big days like All Ireland days, weren't they? Yeah. When this train, of course, came up from County Wexford, which was the big hurling county.
Yes, all the hurlers all travelled that time, you know, on the train to here, to Carlo and Kilkenny.
Yeah.
And one particular occasion, it lost power down. Just about half a mile down.
The train did.
Yeah. And stopped.
Yeah.
And they were trying to get it going again, but all the players all got out and practiced in a field, you know, beside the railway. And people offered 5 grey donkeys that were in the field, you know, come down to help pull the engine up here to Boris. They took the players and officials into a couple of the carriages and brought them on.
To the match.
Yeah. And left the rest. And it was said afterwards at a meeting of, in Wexford, you know, GAA people, that in future that they'd bring the tug-of-war team from somewhere down in Wexford.
To drag the train.
To drag the train if it lost power again.
Again.
So, yeah, so that was one of the episodes.
Despite the rugged territory, this was a well-built line. In order to keep it level, money was lavished on cuttings and great towering embankments. The embankment here at Glynn in County Carlo is still as solid as the flanks of the mountains. Later sections, built cheap, were said to be bumpy as corrugated iron, but here, monuments to quality have stood the test of time. This railway won't be easily forgotten, certainly not by Molly Carroll.
So, Molly, how many generations of your family in this
house? We have 5.
How many?
We're 5. There are 5 generations.
And when you were a little girl, Molly, looking out that little window
and
down along the line.
Oh, God, that was a lovely time.
Was it?
It was, yes.
And what would you be waiting to see?
I'd be waiting to see the train coming up.
Around the corner?
Around the corner. Then I'd be running with my little lamp.
With your little lamp.
Yes.
And what did you do with the little lamp then, at the window?
I stuck it up in the window.
You stuck it up in the window?
Daddy was right behind me back and I stuck it up in the window.
Yeah.
Red was this. And then you turn it this way real quick and you'll have a little bit of yellow. You
so
know.
Red was to tell the train to stop?
Oh, you'd have to tell them to
and
stop.
And they'd have to wait then till you turned it?
Yeah, turn it. And then the white light in this big one then.
Yeah.
This could come on. I would be delighted.
And then on it would come?
And it would come then.
And the train, what happened?
Oh, it had to whistle coming around the corner.
At the whistle board?
Oh, yes, it had to whistle coming around the corner.
So you'd know it was coming?
We'd know the train was coming then.
Yeah.
Because if you wouldn't know that, you was finished.
Well, now, there was an incident, Molly, wasn't there, when the train got stuck in the snow once. It was a tragic time.
There above, Marley Bridge.
Marley Bridge.
Between Marley Bridge and Finland's Bridge.
And a young man
was involved. Yeah. Newman was his name.
Yeah.
Then he young.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was with the poor fella.
And what happened to him?
Sure, when he got up on the fender, you see, to throw down the coal.
Yeah.
Do you know?
Yeah.
He was too near the bridge.
Oh.
Oh, God, and the poor fellow, oh, God, the poor head.
And the train went and he hit the bridge?
Yes.
That was sad.
They used to feed at our house.
Yes.
Yeah. And you know what they used to do?
What?
Fry the mate on the shovel.
Which, the shovel that they used for
yes.
the coal? And it was that hot?
Yes, they had the fire on the ground, same as anyone else.
And they'd grill the steak on the train coals?
They had no steak, it's fried rashers.
Fried rashers?
Yeah, they had no steak. Steak is made, is beef.
And they'd grill them in the train?
They'd grill them in the train, and it was lovely. The finest rashers you ever ate. And you used to have a big tommy can and put it in there on the fender, and then in the fire, and then take it out to be boiled, and they'd throw in the tea.
And did it taste good, Mum?
Oh, it was lovely. You could stand on it, it was so thick. You could stand on it. Yeah. Oh, God, it was lovely.
So when it closed down then?
Yeah, I had nothing.
You had nothing to keep you going?
No, I had nothing to look forward to.
And do you remember them coming and taking away the sleepers?
Indeed, I do. Thought I'd do well.
And how did you feel?
Broken-hearted.
Did you?
Yeah, broken-hearted. And still is broken-hearted today. Because you have nobody.
Mm. And did you tell them that when they were taking the sleepers?
I did, and I gave out to
them. A lot of lifetimes taken up in 2 hours.
All our lifetime was taken up then, it was gone. So my daddy was in the bed for 3 days and wouldn't get up. We thought he'd die.
Because he was broken-hearted?
He was broken-hearted, why wouldn't he? And he on the railway since 1911. I'm sure that wasn't fair either.
It was all over.
All over. That was the little path we used to have to walk on.
Yeah.
And these were the sleepers going across here. And the rails was going down straight there. Yeah.
The Barrow Waterway and its barges always shadowed the railway, competing for its freight and probably contributing to its decline. For 2 centuries, the Grand Canal Barrow Navigation has linked all of this area with Dublin in the north and Waterford in the southeast. And here, only 2 miles away from Glynn and the railway, is the last lock in that navigation at St Mullins. From here, the river is tidal, running down to the sea. It was the traditional transport system to use, and indeed, Odlam's flour mills in St Mullins, one of the few big enterprises in the area, used the waterway, not the local train, for freight. Well, people here would always choose the river. It runs in their veins, and it always has. That's what keeps them here, and brings the holidaymakers here. When St. Moling, the patron saint of the area, ministered here in the 7th century, he started the first ferry service in a raft across the Barrow. He built a mill, a church, he worked miracles, and his deeds are chronicled in the Book of Mulling displayed beside the Book of Kells in Trinity College Dublin. Indeed, it's said that the book was always strapped to the 14th century warrior king Art McMurra Kavanagh when he rode into battle. Art is buried here, and it's the traditional burial place of the Kavanagh family. In fact, in this country, you never stray very far from the Kavanaghs, and we come across another one here above the river at Cool Hill Castle. Locals claim that this is the original home of Eileen Kavanagh, the lady of the famous love song Eileen O'Roon. The story goes that Eileen was being forced to marry an elderly Norman knight. But at a feast on the eve of the wedding, her young lover, Carlo Dolly, comes disguised as a harpist. He sings to her in Irish, "Will you come or will you stay?" She sings back, "I'll come, I'll flee with my love." They escaped that night up the River Barrow. Hundreds of years later, Eileen and Carl could have escaped down this railway line. It was the way my own grandfather chose to make his escape. It was Easter Monday, 1916, and he was head of the 4th Carlo Brigade of the Volunteers, the IRA, due to be arrested after the outbreak of the Rising in Dublin. So he proposed to my grandmother, who didn't at all approve of his political activities. Still, she married him secretly in Boris that very day with a borrowed wedding ring. They made their way to Palace East Station, too small for the British forces to keep under surveillance. Here they caught the train for Kerry, but the British were waiting for my grandfather, who was jailed in the Curra and then in Frongook. They didn't even have a honeymoon night together.
I often think of my grandmother setting out on her married life from this station, disagreeing sharply with her husband about the use of violence, but going with him all the same.
This great tunnel outside New Ross brought the line a vital step nearer to Waterford. Begun in 1882, it took 5 years to build and took probably as many lives through explosions and landfalls. I didn't want to go in there on my own, so local railway enthusiast Mark Minahan came with me.
But listen, this is the third longest tunnel in the country, this one.
So, I believe. I've been told that. I thought it was the longest tunnel in the world when I was a child. But
well, if you live in New Ross, yes, it was the longest tunnel.
That's right. So. This railway was done by the Dublin, Wicklow and Wexford Railway. And in 1904, the link was made between New Ross and Waterford. So there were now two ways to Dublin from Waterford. So they had a race with both trains leaving Waterford.
And there were two different sort of drivers, weren't they?
The driver of the Great Southern and Western was a man called Cavanagh from Waterford, and he was very proud, I mean, as most train drivers were at the time, he was very proud that nobody could outdo him on his line.
And I believe he got held up at one point, and he cursed for 5 minutes and never used the same curse words twice.
That's which was supposed to be a major achievement.
And the other fella then, Wheeler was a different class of
Wheeler
fella.
Wheeler was a rules and regulations man who went by all the rules, which in normal circumstances you couldn't fault him for. But one of the rules was that goods trains had to crawl through all stations. Funnily enough, on this part of the line, he made up a bit of time.
He flew through here. But then Palace East.
From Palace East on, he took it very slowly and did it all according to the rules.
And as a result...
They lost the race.
They lost the race.
Well, they hated one another and there was no love lost. There was very little communication between them thereafter. But Cavanagh's son went to Dublin and met up with Wheeler's daughter. And they married. So the two older fellas had to bury the hatchet on the thing and make up their differences.
And smile at one another
across the family album. Across the family album, is right.
So it was a sort of a railway romance.
That's right.
You used to come in here as a kid, didn't you?
Certainly up to the age of 10 or 12, I came here quite a lot. The tunnel and the railway and the bridge out there were very interesting to youngsters around this area, as you can imagine. And we used to come in here and wait for the train to come sometimes.
Where?
There were little alcoves along the side here, and we used to crawl.
Like this?
They look much smaller now. They seem to be bigger at the time.
You fit in there now?
Well, obviously, I was a lot smaller at that stage. But we'd come in here and we'd wait for the train to come along.
Yeah.
And we'd petrified with fright. Yeah. And the train would come in, you'd see it appear with the smoke and sparks and everything coming out of the chimney.
Yeah.
And we had a very strong definition of hell when we were kids, and that came as close as you could get to hell, you know, this fire and brimstone and the whole lot happening, and the whole place full of noise, and it was very, very frightening.
One way or another, they were mighty men, the men for whom no bridge was too wide, no tunnel too long. By the time you arrive at this point above New Ross, you can't help but admire the ambition which spanned whole valleys and mountains, always pushing on to the finish.
And this is the end of our journey, the point at which the two great pathways meet. The Barrow and Grand Canal navigation begun in the 18th century, and the railway very much an achievement of the 19th century. For years they competed for passengers, competed for freight, but now the days of competition are over.
Time and tide has run out for both of them. Now the freight runs not on majestic rail and river, but on noisy roads. The sleepers are gone, the metal is rusted, and no commercial traffic comes up the river beyond the bridge in New Ross. This place is good for nothing now but pleasure. For floating restaurants, for evening trips and daydreams. For those who want to escape the present and to find the past. The permanent ways have changed, but these were the old ways, the quieter and the simpler ways.
And the book to accompany this television series, Off the Beaten Track, is now available from bookshops nationwide.